negative.
Okay, good morning, everybody. We're going to commence our meeting of the Standing Policy Committee on Protection, Community Services and Parks. Good morning. My name is Mike Pakakan. I'll be chairing today's meeting. I'm pleased to be joined by my council colleagues. We have Councillor Russ Wyatt. We have Councillor Ross Eady, Councillor John Orlico, our clerk, Mr. Andrew Poitras, and several members of our public administration. I'd like to ask for adoption of the previous minutes. Moved by Councillor Eady. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Carried. We have a few registered delegates here. First up is Councillor Mays. I'll see him here. So we'll move on to the next delegation. Carol Phillips, Executive Director, accompanied by Jim August, Chair of the Winnipeg Arts Council, to be heard in support of the Winnipeg Arts Council 2016 Annual Report. Good morning.
Good morning.
Morning.
Good
morning. Nice to be first.
Great. So you're here on the 2016 Annual Report?
Yes.
So I'll give a short introduction, and then Carol will give an overview of the last year, which we believe was a very successful year. We had a number of artists and organizations involved. We go through a very thorough... how many artists actually do get in our funds?
Somewhere in this report.
Anyway, and the fact is, though, that they're really the selections that are made by other artists. So panels are put together, and they're volunteer, and they come in and do the reviews. And it's really quite an impressive and a process that works. And we don't get pushback on from artists who, when they see others that have been selected. So we're very proud of that. Just very briefly, so in the report here with the review, I opened it up with a comment by Jane Jacobs and it talking about how important art is to cities. And Jane Jacobs, as we know, is a very prominent and highly regarded, although passed away a number of years ago. In fact, I think she was in Winnipeg doing a tour at one time. So we kind of that model of using art as city building, as community development, and the like. And that's what we really do try to move and have been moving in that direction more and more. And we see it with the public art particularly and the great work that we think has occurred there and the kind of community response. And we do work with community areas, people in communities to get those projects, projects helping, happening. And the big part of all this is obviously the City of Winnipeg, because without this arrangement we have, which is really us as an arm's length entity, we are the City of Winnipeg. We're an extension of the City of Winnipeg, and therefore want to operate at a very high level so that people understand that their resources are being spent in an effective manner. So just as that as an intro, I'll turn it over to Carol, and she can go through the report.
We've submitted the report several weeks ago, so I know you have it there digitally. But just to give you a summary, what we did this year was fully acknowledge the support of the City of Winnipeg in 2015 and 16 and the additional funds that we most gratefully received. We like to think, and I think it's more than just that, but Winnipeg is one of the best places in the world to be an artist, and that is, of course, what we strive for at the Winnipeg Arts Council. The day that it can truly be confirmed. The City of Winnipeg exhibited its pride and confidence in its artists and arts organization by increasing investment in 15 and 16, as was reported. And all of the funds over those 2 years directly resulted in increased funds to the arts directly, plus additional support for implementation of new programs. It benefited individual artists and arts organizations across the board. Additionally, our arts development programs, which we create in order to engage community in as many ways as possible and at no cost, those projects were enhanced. And for the first time, we were able to invest in Nuit Blanche, which gave us the theme for our report this year of wonderful illuminated art pieces in the night. And last year was a tremendous experience of strolling Winnipeg streets with thousands of people downtown experiencing the artwork. Connecting communities and assuring accessible arts experiences is so important. And we try and create programs that will do that. The new dollars have also supported our consultation and the foundation work that has been accomplished for the Indigenous Arts Leadership Fellowship Program, and that will launch in the fall of 17, so in the next couple of months. There have been many opportunities for citizens to participate in the arts through what we call Art Matters and the conversations. We have guest speakers. Last year we welcomed Gary Steingart and Mira Nair. And both of those artists as immigrants reflected on their careers as artist immigrants, and it was extremely enlightening. Our Art Matters videos were screened at two Winnipeg cinemas, gaining, I hope, higher profile for the arts and, again, connecting to community. Additional funding was also given to our Youth with Art program, pairing artists and communities to give voice to youth-centered creative experience. Public art exploded in Winnipeg in 2016, yet again, with more and more opportunities for Winnipeg artists to be involved. For the first time, significant dollars have been included in the City of Winnipeg capital project for the inclusion of public art, and that is now taking place more and more. For example, each of the seven sites along the Southwest Rapid Transit Extension will be enhanced by public art. The Winnipeg Arts Council also received funds from the Government of Canada through the Canada 150 Fund, specifically for a series of artworks to be created by Indigenous artists. These artworks will be situated in Air Canada Park and hopefully completed by the end of 2017. We continue to pursue any opportunity for special funding in order to supplement the investment of the city. In 2016, I think as a special note, the Winnipeg Arts Council received the first National Public Art Award of Excellence presented by the Creative City Network of Canada. And I'd like to add that the City of Winnipeg is also to be commended for the support they have given to the public art program since it was established more than 12 years ago. I would also like to add our official thanks, which we do most sincerely, to Mayor Bowman and to each member of City Council for their commitment to and investment in the arts in Winnipeg. This standing committee receives our submissions always with great interest and support. And we are grateful to the City Clerk's Office, the Office of the CAO and the COO, and all the city officials who assist Winnipeg Arts Council programs and initiatives. There is, of course, an awful lot of detail, but if there are any questions or observations, we would certainly welcome that discussion.
Thank you very much. That's both of you. Questions, comments? And just want to thank you both for the work that you do. And just a quick question, does the arts within the City of Winnipeg continues to be an economic driver? The number that that's thrown around, I believe, is for every dollar of municipal investment, it leverages, I believe, around 18.
About dollars. $18 other dollars for arts organizations, yeah. That comes from the study that Prairie Research has provided. They've done two studies, one in 2011 and one in 2015, so that confirms that figure. And the arts are keeping apace with economic advancement in Winnipeg and making a huge contribution.
And just yesterday, we had the opening of the Northeast Exchange District of all the infrastructure works that were happening there. And there was an artist there who was working with the Arts Council.
Yeah, just to give you a little bit of background there, Sean McLaughlin, the Winnipeg Arts Council provided, located, advised Centre Venture, and worked with them in a partnership to put Sean on the design team. And I think it really shows in what has happened in that section of the city. It's pretty beautiful.
Elements. Yeah, a lot of great elements, so I encourage everyone here to check it out and walk through it. It's incredible. Well, thanks, Carol, for your work on the Mayor's Task Force on Heritage, Arts, and Culture. This is the first time I've had an opportunity to thank you publicly on that matter, so thank you very much for your involvement as well with that file.
Well, thank you, Councillor. It's a great pleasure, and I hope we can continue that process.
Have a great day.
Thank you so much.
Thanks for the support.
Next up, I'd like to suspend the rules. This is a gentleman, Thomas Albert Prince Jr., would like to speak on item number one, the facility renaming of Sergeant Tommy Prince Place. If I can get suspend the rules. Moved by Councillor Eadie. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Carried. Mr. Prince, good morning. Have a seat at the far end of the table there. Welcome to City Hall.
Morning.
Morning. So you're the son of Sergeant Tommy Prince.
Yes, I am, sir.
And you're speaking in favor of the proposal to rename the North End Recreation Leisure Facility in your late father's honor, Sergeant Tommy Prince Place.
Yes, I am, sir.
You have 10 minutes.
On behalf of the Prince family, I'm honored to be here today for this renaming. The Prince family would like to say thank you to the Mayor Bowman, Mr. Mike Bactigan, and the rest of the committee for going forward with this project. We think that anything to do with the Prince, with Sergeant Tommy Prince, with renaming or naming, is a positive thing for the city and parks and recs, whatever it may be. We think it's a positive thing. If it's going to change the youth, the committee, the community, we're all for it. The family says, yes, by all means. We have no disagreements or anything with it. Throughout the years, the city has been very positive in honoring our deceased father. We say thank you. Once again, I say, and I think it's a very positive thing, and we hope to see you all there. So with that being said, the family and I say thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Prince. Appreciate that. Is there any questions or comments?
Delegation?
Thanks very much. Fantastic. Thanks for all your work that you do with the Cadet Corps. I know you're involved with the Sergeant Tommy Prince Cadet Corps as well, fairly heavily at the Freight House, and so thank you for your work.
Yes, I try to do everything for the Cadet Corps, and I also have some veterans friends I work close with. I am a member of the Aboriginal Veterans Association, and I do a lot of work with Mr. Blackhawk, Richard Blackhawk. I do a lot of work with him also.
Great. Thank you very much.
All right, thank you.
Okay, so is no other delegations or suspension of rules? Move on to item number one.
Councillor Mays.
Councillor Mays was registered, but he's not here, so
I see.
Oh. All right.
I will see him here. Okay, we'll move on to item number one. If Councillor Oyelowo, if you could take the chair.
Sure.
Can I put Councillor Eadie in the chair?
I shall take the chair. Thank you.
I'd like to move item number one, the facility renaming of the Sergeant Tommy Prince Place as well. Councillor, I'd like to ask that the administration provide a verbal update at a later date to this committee in terms of some sign options for the facility and some associated costs. I'd like to be able to provide a small grant to provide that the funding source to make this happen.
Great motion. All right, all those in favor?
Aye.
Is anybody opposed? Of course not. It's carried.
Really?
Okay.
All right. Now we don't have to say North Centennial Recreation Leisure Center.
There we go. Fantastic.
You have the chair back.
Thank you. Thanks, Councillor. Okay, number two, trail renaming, McGeezy Parkway.
Yes, colleagues, I moved this from the Lord Selkirk Westcliff Community Committee. It's called the North Winnipeg Parkway at the moment, and that's the active transportation trail that takes you from the forks all the way north to the north limit of the city. And actually, I'm not sure if West St. Paul is continuing that path or not, but it's a path that goes all the way up the Red River and utilizes various streets, and and I can't pronounce it properly, but it's an Ojibwe word for eagle. And what has happened is there was a look at trying to rename a street itself, but there was a number of difficulties. But I think that in the spirit of recognizing the Anishinaabe people who for thousands of years gathered along the river, and it has been observed that eagles are feeding along the Red River. And I've heard from residents down in the south part of my ward, as well as up to the more northern part, up by Kildonan Park. And I think that this would be an appropriate acknowledgement that where these lands came from. And one of the issues that may arise as it goes along, I think the administration's already looking at how to rename, and there needs to be, I can't remember if right in the motion it mentioned, but if there's required for required signage, and I think we have to develop a kind of style of sign that somehow portrays to English-speaking people that Mguzi is means eagle. So somehow we'd have to, I don't know how we're going to do that signage, but I'm thinking that the land dedication reserve could be a source of funds for putting up appropriate signage. So anyway, I think it is a compromise, but I think it's a bigger thing because it really acknowledges all the way up the river there'll be various places for signage so people know how to follow the path as they're going along. So,
great initiative, Councillor. I just want to ask you a quick question of clarification. This the current parkway that you're looking through, is it a renaming of the North Winnipeg Parkway, or is it just a certain section of the North Winnipeg Parkway?
No, it's renaming the whole North Winnipeg Parkway.
Did you need to ask our public service any questions for clarification at all this point?
Well, I initiated some dialogue with P&D. It comes to this committee, not sure why, but you'll notice the number ones in Transcona and from St. Natal, I think. But
so my question to you is the North Winnipeg Parkway, which is a well-known...
Well, just the history on the naming of that trail and several others. There's... that was done by the Winnipeg Trails Association quite a long time ago. I can't remember the initiative, but there was a federal initiative and all kinds of different things, right? So there is some dialogue happening with people who have been involved with Winnipeg Trails and that sort of stuff as well. So I don't know if that's a good answer for you.
Okay. Well, to be honest with you, I thought it would be sort of like an honorific name, where we're keeping the North Winnipeg Parkway name, but a certain portion of that trail would have been Mguzi Parkway. But now I understand that you're looking to rename the North Winnipeg Parkway as Mguzi Parkway. Is that correct?
I'm hoping so. Yeah.
Councillor
Kelly. Okay. I guess the other question I'd have, which is that's a good question. But like, if it's that long, how many signs would it be? What would the signs look like? How much is it going to cost? Because there's no funding in here that I see, and that goes for all of them. So I think I'd like the administration maybe come up.
Yeah, Mr. Donkey, and
we're sending this to the administration to identify sources of funding.
Yeah, I mean, let's come back.
Yeah, and then come back with the report.
Yeah, like, good.
Morning.
Hi. Morning. I've got Dave Donkey here up at Stanley White House, who is our responsibilities for active transportation planning in the city.
Yeah.
So she's here to answer questions. I think what Councillor Eady pointed out was clear that, yeah, there needs to be a rebranding of the entire trail. So you're right about that. And there needs to be a funding source identified, which you talked about, LDR. For rebranding it. Any other thoughts?
Yeah, in 2006, a report went to council to consolidate some of, there were 16 trails associated with the rivers, and it was understood that it's complicated to have too many names of trails for the public, so it was created a trail system associated with the river in corridors. So we had the North Winnipeg Parkway, Kildona Parkway, South Winnipeg Parkway. So the naming was in relationship to the river. So to do a piece of it, I think, would be a concern unless it would still probably fundamentally be called the North Winnipeg Parkway as that corridor. And it is branded as such as of 2006. So we would have to make efforts to rebrand that. We would work with the Winnipeg Trails Association and so on to make sure that we had the graphics and everything that we needed. And maybe publicly rename it, because it'll probably, the original name would probably stick. So we'd need to make some efforts to publicly rename it so that people understand that the full trail is named that.
I have a question.
Yeah.
Is there actually signage that directs people how to follow it? Because
it's not a complete trail yet. So one of the things that we wanted to do in the coming years is to look at completing that trail connection to make sure that that is a full corridor. So
my question really is, I've heard as the development of the AT path mm-hmm. goes along there, I've noted that a number of people are using different names.
Yeah. Some of the old names stuck still because of branding associations and just people's history with those trails. So the North Winnipeg Parkway was sort of the greater name for the system, if you will, that whole connectivity. But you know, if council believes we should rename it, I mean, the association is very important in recognizing the first name. But we would need to make some effort and get some money to rebrand it.
So when you say rebrand, is that
establishing a sign system? Yeah, and because it's not a complete path,
Stephanie, you're working on signage to help people mm-hmm. navigate these things anyway. Yeah. Are we not, Stephanie?
Yes, we are, and a wayfinding system. So yeah, I think the timing is good.
That's one of my questions. So we're already. If we could, I'd like to, now that I'm knowing that this is on your path anyways.
We're.
The path is good. so we're already doing that.
Yeah.
So pretty well all this motion is saying today is, and I'll ask why, how, it's just instead of calling it that, let's change it to this name.
Yeah.
Okay, so that's interesting. Now, this is part of the AT path?
Network, yeah.
The network, the connectivity network stuff.
Yeah.
So this is part of that. So the funding's already been identified yet, or?
The funding has been identified for a study of the to complete the connection all the way from the Kildona Settler Bridge to the Forks.
So I guess.
One thing that I think would be important is to engage. You mentioned you engaged the Winnipeg Trails. I think it would be important to engage those stakeholders and people like the Forks who are invested in you know, connecting to the Forks and the waterfront, to make sure that they are aware and understand this, so that we have consistent naming.
Well, then should we not do this yet then? Until you've had your consultation with the people and stuff? Because if we do this today, we're renaming it.
Yeah.
This.
I think that dialogue is important. I'm not sure the council has had
that. The motion is to send this to the my intention was to send this to the administration
to report back
and work out and report back and work out
I think that would
how
be
it, how
that
it all go. I
yeah.
wasn't
Good.
My intention to
yeah,
just
I
automatically
yeah
sorry
I just
okay.
didn't say that
no, no, no.
It's like all right so as a member I'm fine with that yeah so you guys just give your report you do your other study corridor stuff and then
yeah.
figure out what signage you want, how much it'll cost, where you're going to fund it from, whatever source of money, and then you'll come back to this committee to show us. Is that accurate?
I think that's
that
based on this discussion.
Yeah.
That makes
sounds
more
accurate.
Sense.
To me?
Yeah.
All right, I'm good with that.
Okay. Yeah, the motion is basically to direct the public service to report back on the matter, and I'm not sure if you have a specific timeline or if this is to come in conjunction with another report. Or
Stephanie, one other question I had was, now I know there's money set aside. I don't know for which AT trails or paths, but isn't there money also set aside for, like you were talking about a study that's mm-hmm. going to go about completing it, but there's also an initiative, correct me if I'm wrong, to look at wayfinding for
yes.
cyclists using AT trails, right?
Yes. And so we have projected money, recommended money in 2018 to come up with a strategy for wayfinding, and the objectives of that would be to pilot a project related to BRT and to connecting to the downtown.
Right.
Yeah, so this would be one in line with that. And that would be rolled out. We look to roll that out in 2019.
So what kind of timeline do you think you need to report back?
Minimum 100. That.
180 days.
180 days.
I'm here to coach her on
that. Let me give you a prototype of the day to
have. I'll move that we send it to administration with a report back in 180 days.
Motion's on the table. All those in favor? Opposed? Carried. Thank you very much. Next one is the Pegwa Street trail naming, Marianne Cirelli Trail. Councillor Wyatt.
Yeah, thanks, Mr. Chairman. And the next one, this is not, I want to point out, this is not a renaming. These trails have been built. Funding has been identified through my land dedication reserve. We're actually working with the community as we speak. Transcon Trails met with you the other day. Stephanie was away, but now she's back, so we'll be able to bring her into the... We're identifying, wayfinding, the trailhead locations, I should say. And Marianne was someone who served the community from 1990 to 2003, 13 years. She was very passionate. She did a lot. She actually started the Transcon Trails Association under her leadership. She got that committee going at a very early time when trails was just kind of a concept that we were bringing to Winnipeg. So this came from the representatives of the Trails Association, and so I thought it was very fitting. It runs, the trails location is actually located in the heart of her, what she represented, Radisson, which was the old boundaries of Radisson. So this trail was actually in the heart of those old boundaries. She was in many ways a trailblazer. She did a lot of great work in terms of, she was very involved with daycare issues. She was very involved with active transportation. She pushed for better sidewalks. She, lobbied the province to get involved with stuff like that. She was really involved with, we had a big contaminated site left by Dom Tar. They made creosote. Creosote was used to actually make all the ties in the railway for like 100 years. And they left the community and left a massive brownfield site. She pushed hard to get that cleaned up, which actually it migrated into people's backyards. It was quite a mess, which ultimately created the Transcona Bioreserve. So she was very, very, she pushed very hard on that front. And just on a lot of environmental issues, she was big. And so it's a privilege to be able to do this today. So. And funding's been identified, so, and it's a new trail. So
fantastic. Thank you very much, Councillor Wyatt. Good motion. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Carried. Thank you. Item number four is a Transcona Boulevard active transportation path naming, Park City Park Pathway.
Yeah, Park City is kind of the nickname. It was the moniker given to the community prior to Union City. It was what we marketed the community, and now the Transcona business adopted it. This is going to run northeast-west, and along Transcona Boulevard. So
this is a similar situation. You have LDR.
Yes, it's also, we're actually using LDR funds not just for these trails, but we're actually working on the existing trails because there's a lot of trailhead signs missing along the Panama pathway, along the Transcona pathway, along the newly constructed pathway along Plessy by the underpass. So we're going to use that to get some branding in terms of and get some identification. But the wayfinding, I think, is terrific because what we're finding is people are coming into the community who aren't from the community, and then they're wondering on a trail, they're wondering, well, what cross street is this?
Yeah.
They just don't know what they're getting off onto, and that's something we've heard is an issue. So to have it kind of what you see in Europe and other cities in North America where you have the trail branding of the name of the trail on two sides, and then on the other two sides you have the actual wayfinding, the street name. It could look quite sharp. So anyway, yeah.
Okay. Yeah. The motion's on the table. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed, carried. And good work, by the way, last week, Councillor Wyatt, at the opening of the Transcona Aquatic Park.
That was, yeah, was fun. You didn't go down the slide.
Did.
That
was
great. No one pushed each other in.
No one pushed each other in. It was a good day.
Well, you had your work on that. And,
yeah, thank you.
And that looks great. Looks great. Looks great.
Thanks for being there.
Yeah.
Next up is the capital budget amendments for the St. Vitale and Windsor Park Library projects. I believe we have staff here to provide an overview. Are we good?
Well, I just have one question.
Okay.
Just about the hydro rebate, is that right?
Sure. Yeah. We'll call up Ms. Fernandez and Mr. Cuddy. Okay. Councillor Edie?
Yeah, it was just... So, the hydro rebate was in regard to... this was for the major renovation. Is the rebate directly related to that project, or...?
The rebate is related to the Windsor Park project.
And, right, directly related to that. Okay.
Yeah, it qualified for a rebate under the Energy Modeling Assistance Initiative.
Oh, good.
Yeah.
Cool.
So the top-up is, we were just slightly, the budget was $4.668 million, and there was not enough funds within that to do what you need to do here, is that?
That's
for
right.
For Windsor Park?
For Windsor Park, yeah.
This is what we're doing. Right?
And we
need to Windsor Park.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
So the St. Vitale project's already completed, and there was a surplus of 200?
I don't know if it's complete.
No. It's not complete.
It's not completed?
Phase two of the renovation project is just starting. But the bids came in quite competitive, and we're confident with the money we have and the contingency funding that we can transfer $200,000 to Windsor Park to deal with some expenses there that had to do with site costs and site infrastructure costs that were unforeseen. So,
I thought the Windsor Park Library also came in under budget too, in terms of the bid.
Under budget, it was very.
Mr. Benuda's here. He's heading up. Is he? Can
yeah,
you speak?
Brett. Yeah, Brett. Brett.
Actually, in just. Quick answer, I'm sure. The new Windsor Park Library is connected to the Bonnie Vitale pool?
It's not directly.
Yeah, it's not connected.
But it's on the same property.
But there is a bridge. There's a bridge that will go over the waterway.
Right. Okay.
And an external outdoor bridge.
Yes.
Yeah.
Right.
Yes, external.
Not an internal.
Not enclosed, no.
No. No.
Yeah. But I can cross-country ski over there in the winter.
So, Mr. Peter, there was a question regarding the Windsor Park, if that was under budget. Or...
Actually, the award of that project, that contract, was slightly over the estimate. And as a result, we had to dip into our contingency fund. You have to appreciate within the project budget, we have construction budget, and then we have design budget, and we have a contingency fund. So the sum has to be within budget, which it was, but in order to award at the low bid, we had to adjust our contingency, and that actually resulted in the need we have today to deal with the unforeseens that we normally account for in our contingency. It's just that we're a bit shortchanged due to the award value. Yeah.
So that then confirms that the library that's now underway, Transcona will be the first building project, thanks to the leadership of the mayor and EPC, the first building project that will be on budget and on time.
That's right. It really speaks to the new asset management procurement policies.
Thanks to your work as well.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Opening September of next year.
That's right.
Well, there you go. Yeah, I know what he's up to.
No. I got it in writing from the director, not from Brett. Brett's okay. He's good. He's good. I got it from the director.
All right.
Okay.
Yeah. I'll move confirmation of the administration.
Concurrence. Okay. Move concurrence with the report. All those in favor?
Aye.
Carried. Thank you. Next up is sponsor Winnipeg program, stakeholder engagement. We've got a report here for information. Is there any questions? Is there a desire to call up Ms. Pretty? Okay, Councillor Orr, are you moving? Do you have questions, Councillor?
Yeah, I did. Who's here to ask questions?
Yeah, we've got Maureen Pretty here. Janet Thomas.
Morning.
Good morning.
Morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Councilor Wyatt.
So the purpose of this was to look at the future of sponsorship Winnipeg. We did the stakeholder engagement and then to come back and report here.
Right.
So this says to receive his information. So what's happening then? What's the next step?
So what we propose to do, and I believe it's at the back of the report, is that there's a couple things. We had such wonderful feedback from the community center boards. And so we propose to continue to meet with the community center boards to explore some opportunities. In particular, one of the things that we were tasked with from this committee through this process is to figure out how to support groups with varying capacities. And so things that those folks identified for us to work on their behalf was to prospect on their behalf, prepare sponsorship packages. And one of the things that they also talked about was grouping assets. So like assets, like if they've all got soccer pitches or, you know, diamonds, something like that. And so that maybe we could potentially group those and then look for a sponsor for sort of that grouping of that assets. The other thing that they asked us to do was to help them identify the assets that they have available. Although we have some of them listed, the community centers listed, we don't necessarily have their various components. So they asked us to help with that. The other thing that we're going to look at, and we had actually presented it in our business case a while back, was we wanted to streamline the approval process. And what I mean by that is currently the way the policy reads is that all naming rights sponsorships, and it's regardless of the value, must go to council. And so we had, for example, we had, you know, the Raiders Hockey Inc. They had sponsored the naming right to a dressing room. The value was $30,000, and that had to go to council. So what we are suggesting is because the CAO already has delegated authority to approve all non-naming rights sponsorships, we're going to come back and propose to you folks that we up that so that he has the ability to approve up to $200,000. That will be a proposal for your consideration. So that will give you a lot of background for you to think about that. And then, of course, then it would always be if he thought that maybe it should go to council anyway, then, of course, it would go there. The other thing is that community centers had talked a lot about, and this came from all the boards, thresholds for sponsorship. So what that means is they had shared with us that, you know, they've got a lot of businesses within their catchment areas who approach them and they will, you know, want to give some monies to like a breakfast with Santa event. Or, you know, they give them some monies for like a winter or summer carnival. So they said to us, because of the way the policy is, that it has to have either CAO or it has council approval. Is there something that we could do about, you know, identifying thresholds where they would be able to approve? Or, and the other thing is too, I mean, if it's not a sponsorship and just like a BMO comes and says, here's $200 for your barbecue, well, that's a donation and that's a non-issue, right? That's not even, don't even have to worry about that because there are separate processes for that. So what we want to do is come back to you with a report with some of these recommendations and also talk about how we're going to further assist our community centers.
Okay, but I hear what you're saying, but it doesn't say that in the recommendation. The recommendation is just to receive an information. And so my concern is that this will, like a lot of things when you receive this information, all these things you're saying is wonderful, but it doesn't sound like to me it's
going to report back.
Well, yeah, we have it, Councillor White. If, on page 6, we have the proposed amendments to the sponsorship policy, and we do say in there, and you know what, point taken, I guess we don't say it up front, but we probably should have, that we were going to come back. If you look at page 6 of the report, we say that we will come back with a report to council. But I guess maybe we should have said that right up front.
Our business case report that we brought earlier.
But it should be right in, you're right. We should have, yeah, well, no, what he's saying is we should have put, yeah, we're remiss in putting there. Or you can. Okay.
He's right, yeah. Because, yeah, it could just disappear into ether.
Yeah, well, we have no intention. We were hoping that, yeah, we would be able to come back again.
Other question?
So you met with the community center boards, but you and outside of that, there was just two other organizations. You met.
Yes.
Okay, you were now. It's come to my attention that there's a bit of a concern about what happened here with. You have Bueller in here, and you have them talking about their ability to have authority somewhere, somewhere parked out. The concern is raised that apparently your meeting was facilitated by, apparently Charles Osandu attended the meeting?
Well, I did attend because Charles happened to be going that day, but I did, Steve Memko and I, and Tom Thompson, he was there as well. We did talk about sponsorship, and actually, I thought that I had had a great conversation with Steve, and one of the things that he asked me to do was to write a positive report, right, looking for a delegation of authority to run like the Assiniboine Park Conservancy. But that's out of the scope of this program, and that's why, and I told him, I mean, I will include it because that was his feedback, but I don't know where it goes, like something like that goes.
Okay, but you're aware that you've basically, you know, we're in negotiations with them right now on their lease?
Yes.
You used a meeting that had to do with their lease to, for the purpose of your report, which
no.
is somewhat unethical.
No, they were two very different discussions.
No, I have the original letter that was sent by Mr. Osandu to Mr. Memko requesting the meeting.
Yes, no, I know that.
It specifically had to do with the lease. There was nowhere was he given the understanding that the meeting at hand
that I was coming to chat with him. Yes,
no,
absolutely.
No. Excuse me. Don't interrupt me.
But
the meeting at hand had to do with this report before us today, which is the engagement.
Yeah. Yes. That was my understanding. Now, what I can
do. That was not his. He has a letter. He thought the discussion was going to be about his lease and the topic of the lease and the renewal of the lease.
Okay.
Which is one. Now, we negotiate between another party and the lease. I think those negotiations are important, and,
yes.
and we've got to treat them, or else you're not negotiating in good faith. And then for him to, then the shock that he saw when he saw this actually appear, he had no idea that you were meeting with him for the purpose of this report. You've got to remember, a lot of people do not have a clue all the other reports that go on in the city, nor would we expect them to. But
right.
So why would you have included something when the letter from Mr. Osandu was extremely clear?
Okay, I wasn't aware of that letter, but I will tell you that
he even refers to you and inviting you for the purpose of discussing the lease.
My understanding, and this is my understanding, was that I was invited to talk about sponsorship because Councillor Wyatt, I have nothing to do with lease agreements.
No, but in the context of the lease. That was the discussion. It was specifically organized.
Okay, then I'm sorry. Tell you what I can do. If that,
well, it's too late now.
You put it in your report. Well, but we are coming back. So what I can do, if it would work out better, is I can go back and I can meet with Mr. Memko again. You know what, Councillor Wyatt?
I think at this point it's better just to have the discussion here.
We can do that as well.
All right. And I would move that this be laid over so that they can have an opportunity to attend in September.
Absolutely. Sure. Okay.
Let's clear the air. Let's clear the air.
But didn't he know the meeting was on today?
He's got a tournament today with 48 teams coming from across Canada, and he had to get ready so he couldn't make it.
That's just valid.
Yeah,
any issues with the report?
Well, he would be willing to come and speak to this.
Speak to that.
This concern.
Okay. I'm baffled. I really am. I'm baffled. I do have my notes from that meeting. Yeah, I'm sorry, Councillor. I really totally baffled by that. But having said that, I'm sure. Yeah, and I do have my notes from that meeting. That's why I have his recommendation about it.
He went to a meeting with the understanding that the discussion was to pertain to the issue of the renewal of the lease, and he was trying to resolve issues with the public service, and then all of a sudden to see this material appear, a separate report, not pertaining to his lease, but a separate report making commentary on that. on the very issue that one of the... Anyway, I'm not going to beat you
up.
I'm not going to belay this
yeah.
because there's no point in it. And I'm just telling you, and I have copies of the communication from Mosandu, who attended the meeting.
Yes.
Who's been attending the meetings with pertaining to the lease negotiations. Mm-hmm. So... Mm-hmm. And no, he couldn't make it today. He would have loved to come today, but he's got a tournament, John, and it's got a big, massive thing.
It's not time sensitive.
Okay.
So, can we move to late over? Yeah, in September? Yeah, absolutely.
Okay.
That's totally fine.
That was Councilor
Wise.
We're moving late over to our meeting in September. All in favor?
All right.
Okay, great. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. All right, we've got some addendum reports, so if I can get suspension of rules to deal with two addenda items, moved by Councilor Olicole. All those in favor? Opposed? Carried.
Yeah.
First one up is the Winnipeg Arts Council 2016 annual report. We're eager to receive that as information.
Yep.
So moved by Councilor Olicole. Those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Carried. Next one is the field preceptorship fee schedule and agreements to provide field preceptorship. Within the Winnipeg Fire Paramedic Service, I see we have a chief here and the staff. Join us, sir. Are there any questions regarding the field preceptorship?
I just wanted to...
I just want to confirm, is this... I don't know if this is directly related to, but in the last negotiated firefighter contract and prior one, in order to save on overtime... I think they have firefighters who are working through a preceptorship, which is basically kind of like working with the trades. What do they call them? You have an expert in an area, and they're guiding people and
how to become a
firefighter and so
on. Apprenticeship.
Apprenticeship. Thank you. That's what this is, right?
I suppose you could look at it in that fashion. The difference with an apprenticeship is that an apprentice is actually employed by the employer. In this case, they are students.
They're just students.
Oh,
okay.
Yeah.
So this isn't related to the.
No, this is pure teaching. Preceptorship is what they call it. It's like a student physician or a student physiotherapist or whatever you have practicing under the guidance and learning skills under the guidance of an expert preceptor.
So are they actually attending actual emergencies?
Oh yes, part of the this is the advanced care paramedic curriculum out of Red River College, and part of the requirement for that educational program is that certain aspects of their practice they must do in the field under emergency conditions.
Cool.
Moved by Councilor Eadie. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Carried. Consent and adjournment?
Sure.
Councilor White, all those in favor?
Aye.
Great.
Thank you.
Hey, thank you for joining.
Who's has that?
He's on.